Hello, dear friends. Today, I thought I would just give you a summary of my experience this past weekend vending at WhimsyCon, which I attended and sold work at, and I talked on some panels and did a live painting session. So I hope you will enjoy. I got some footage, as you can see, of the live painting. It isn't the most beautiful footage, but this was the best I could do with setting up my camera in an area where it wouldn't intrude on anybody, because I was kind of right beside the pathway of traffic, but I had a little area I could put my camera on, so I was super excited about that. So first, I think I'll just kind of talk a little bit about this convention for those of you who are not familiar. WhimsyCon it's a brand new con, and this was its first year. It's a steampunk convention with kind of a high focus on art, writing, costuming, and steampunk and fantasy culture. Last year, there was another steampunk convention called AnomalyCon, which I think ran for about maybe 5 or 6 years. I can't remember. I started attending AnomalyCon in its second year, and then I think I attended it for about 4 years. So I guess it was probably about 5 years old. I could be confused, though, if it had some really low-key versions before I knew it. I don't know. So unfortunately, last year was AnomalyCon's final year. And the staff members of WhimsyCon, who already run another convention or two in Colorado, I think, decided to create a new steampunk convention. And lucky for all of us vendors and the attendants, it's held in the same hotel, and that makes it feel really familiar, which is nice because I really like the location of it. It's easy to get to, and it's a super classy hotel. Everybody's super nice. So I was pretty excited to learn that there would be another steampunk convention. I wanted to dip my toes in and see how it would be to vend there. The thing about vending at new conventions or smaller conventions is that the sales are not always quite as high as some that might be a little bit bigger, especially if it's a new convention. I feel like I have had pretty decent success with vending at small conventions when I've been there a few times and they get to know me. Oh, by the way, sorry if you hear the shaking. I block my cat Pancake from getting into the room, but somehow she seems to have jumped over the fence I put up and she's now in the room. Probably gonna hear her collar a little bit and possibly some complaining because she's kind of a brat, but I love her. Now I lost my train of thought. Yeah, so when you do small conventions, sometimes I feel that if you've been there for a while, you can develop kind of a great relationship with the smaller amount of attendees. And it's a little bit more of an intimate setting, which is nice. Whereas if it's a huge convention, you've got all these new people and it might be a little bit more evened out, so you might not quite have that relationship with the people at the convention. So it's cool. Every convention kind of has its different pros and cons. And you know what? I hear this little beanbag of mine eating super loudly with her collar, so I'm just gonna go ahead and pause this and stop her and move her food into a different room. Give me just 1 second. I am so sorry about that. I hope you do not mind these more candid, kind of spontaneous vlog style recordings, because I don't know, things happen and it's so time consuming if you try to make everything absolutely perfect. So let me know if it's annoying to hear these more, like I said, candid ones. And if so, if it seems to not go over well, I can always try to edit a little bit more, but I personally kind of like hearing the more real, unscripted vlogs when I'm listening to podcasts and stuff, so maybe you guys do too. Anyway, as I was saying, with the smaller conventions and the bigger conventions, you kind of have all these different pros and cons, which are super interesting. And because this convention was in its first year, sales were not particularly high, which is to be expected. You can always have unexpected little, like, wow conventions in their first year sometimes where you're like, oh my gosh. But more often than not, they'll be a little bit slower than the larger ones or the longer running ones. And I went in expecting that, so I wasn't terribly disappointed or anything. I did sell a few larger prints at least, and a couple of small originals in addition to some smaller prints, so that was nice. I always feel just extremely grateful and humbled that people actually want to put money into buying my work. So I was incredibly happy and grateful for that. But I think what the best part of this convention was for me, and what the best part has been every year with these steampunk conventions is the people, especially the other vendors, and particularly the artist vendors. You know, you kind of get this almost, a lot of us like to call it con family, like these are people you only see maybe once or a few times a year at conventions, but when you do, it's like this fun reunion. You get to sit down and talk about how things are going with your art and your life and business talk that probably is super boring to non-artist friends and family, but it's really interesting to us. And I really, really enjoy that. I always learn so much from my peers, and especially at this convention, being on panels with them, I feel like I come home feeling just refreshed and renewed and full of new possibilities. And this year, like has been the case every year with these steampunk conventions, I did a few panels with usually 3 to 5 artists on a panel. And the topics I usually choose to be a part of are the art business talks or just the art lifestyle talks, because I'm not really qualified to be on any of the others, which are usually costuming and writing or Victorian culture, and I would not know anything about that. So I like to do the business and kind of art lifestyle talks. And I think this year I was on about, 6 different panels over the weekend. I did one regarding how to handle commissions and client work. I did one regarding kind of just following and pursuing your dreams despite, you know, the way the world might try to hold you back. I did one about fan art. I'm not entirely sure why I got put on that one. Sometimes you get snuck into a panel that I think they just need more people on it. And it was myself and another gentleman named Chaz Kemp, who's just a gorgeous artist and person. He's wonderful. Him and his wife are so kind and such lovely people. I highly recommend looking up Chaz Kemp. You will probably enjoy his work. But neither of us really does much fan art. And so we were able to luckily wrangle a couple artists in with us and get a bit more perspective on it. And that was a huge blessing, because then I felt like I got to really learn from other people's perspectives. And I was able to kind of give a little input, because obviously my fandoms have inspired my art, but I just never feel a big need to do fan art for some reason. So it was great hearing everybody else's perspective on it though. I think I did a panel on ethics within art, kind of regarding how you should be with clients, how you should be with other artists, and just how you should behave as an artist and business owner in general. And that was quite interesting discussion. I enjoyed that. And I'm kind of drawing a blank on a couple of the others, but like I said, I personally gained so much insight and inspiration from hearing my peers talk. I just always feel like, wow, why didn't I think of that? Or wow, what a great way to think about this perspective. Like, there was a girl on a panel with me, her name was Brenna, I believe, and she put into words something I never quite could in regards to the stresses of this lifestyle, and that was, she said there was a big difference between stress and suffering, I think. And when she said it, it just really resonated with me, because I know it can be a little bit hard for some well-meaning friends and family members occasionally to understand why I want to keep doing this, because it does come with quite a bit of stress. And I've never been able to articulate exactly what it is that makes me want to do it, other than I'm just so madly infatuated with doing art that it, you know, it kind of goes above any of the struggles I might have with it. Like, any pain or struggle that comes with it, no matter how intense, can't really compare to the joy I get out of it, and that's why I want to keep going. But I just loved that quote about there's a difference between stress and suffering. I don't know why, I just thought that was so wise, and that girl was so kind and beautiful. The way she spoke was absolutely lovely. I want to talk just a little bit about the things I was able to take away from this convention that made it such a positive experience, despite that it wasn't the biggest or the fanciest or the most profitable convention. And I want to just briefly touch on a couple of tips I have for making the best of an event that isn't maybe quite what you expected, or not necessarily expected, but quite what you would wish for as far as like sales go. I'll probably do a longer video on that maybe later in the year, after I've done a few more conventions in the year and see the different experiences I can compare with, but I wanted to touch on it briefly. I feel that with a lot of things, If they don't go quite as you expected, and maybe they aren't going quite as you would wish for, you can often still get a great takeaway from them. And what I mean is you can find ways to make them enjoyable or beneficial. You know, obviously, if you're trying to make a living off of your art, and by art, I could mean writing or dancing or music. When I say art, you guys just know that I mean pretty much anything creative, because I don't want to exclude any creative person. I think a lot of us can relate to each other. My husband is always talking about how much he relates to my career just with his own pursuits with his musical career. And I work with musicians a lot, and I've heard the same with some of my clients. We can all kind of sit down and, you know, resonate with one another about all the woes and the great things and the bad things about these creative careers. So I feel that when you're at an event and it isn't quite what you hope for, you can usually take something away that's close to or just as valuable as the money. And that can be hard to see sometimes, because if you are relying on it for your whole income, or even if you're not relying on it for your whole income, but you're just trying to get started so that you can quit your day job or whatever, it can be really, really disheartening when you don't make the sales you were hoping for. And I've certainly had events where I left feeling really discouraged, because I truly needed the money at the time. And currently, Willow and I are getting ready to move, and the moving costs, as well as the fact that it's tax time, and just being self-employed with taxes, it's an absolute beast of its own. It definitely does come with expenses. As some of you might know, my husband also just immigrated here from France, so he doesn't actually have a work license yet. So I've been supporting the both of us a little bit, and it does, of course, weigh on the finances, especially being a self-employed artist who isn't quite as far into her career as some other artists might be. I'm extremely, extremely grateful that I'm able to make a living off of this. I feel incredibly blessed, but it isn't always easy. And it can make it a big challenge when I do an event and the finances just aren't there. With this event, as I said, I was kind of prepared for that because I realized it was a smaller event. So I didn't feel terribly devastated or anything, and I was lucky enough to get a couple of good sales. But I've had other events where things just didn't go well and I wasn't sure what to do, and I became very discouraged, which I knew in turn customers could probably feel, and therefore it would probably discourage them from wanting to buy anything. And what I'll usually do when I hit those moments is I'll kind of look around me, try to see what is positive, what can I possibly go home with that I can take value from, that I can use to up my sales and my business model at another time. And that can be anything from walking around and talking to my peers, talking to other artists, asking how their experience is, not in an extremely nosy way like, oh, how much did you make, which I'm actually quite open about talking numbers. If you know, if any of you ever run into me at a convention, I like talking and being pretty honest about that stuff. But it's not the best thing to approach artists with, especially if you don't notice, you know, waltzing up to them and asking how much they make can be a little off-putting for some people. But you know, talking with your peers, talking business tactics, asking how their time is going can give you either somebody to commiserate with if it's not going so well for them, or somebody to get advice from, get feedback from. You can walk around with a portfolio of your artwork and look for people who are open to giving you critique. Again, you want to be respectful and make sure they aren't super busy and you're not interrupting their day. But I've had some artists that have been incredibly open about that, and that can be really inspiring as well. Overall, for me, what I find is that I sometimes just have to change my mindset, which can sometimes not be super possible to do, or sometimes I admit what happens to me is I'll be able to change it during the event, but then after the event, when the adrenaline wears off, I'll kind of feel a little bit down and a little bit drained, just knowing that it wasn't quite what I had hoped for. But at least in the moment, if you can change your mindset, it can make for a lot better interaction with people, which can sometimes lead to more sales or just building a better relationship with your followers. And so sometimes I will just completely change my mind about what I came for and decide, okay, clearly these sales aren't going to be here where I had wanted them to be. So what else can I do? How can I make this great? And let's just forget about the money for a moment. And if I can talk myself into feeling that way, it It makes for so much better of an experience for myself and my assistants who have to put up with me. And it's not always easy to do, and that's okay too, but it's just a little tip for if you're ever in the same situation. With this convention, I had so much fun with my fellow artists and with my assistants that I didn't feel like I had to cheer myself up a ton or anything. Especially being on the panels and getting so much great advice, I felt really refreshed and fulfilled overall more than anything. But as I said, with other events, sometimes I've gotten into kind of a negative mindset and had to get myself out of it. So as I close out this kind of longer talk, I wanted to just talk a bit about my experience with live painting. This was my third year doing this during the tea at these steampunk conventions. They always have this big, elaborate tea party that has just tons of beautiful, beautiful people in steampunk and fantasy and Victorian costumes that are mind-blowing and make me feel incredibly underdressed. And I always feel like the people at these tea parties, I think they just kind of get into this mindset of, let's be fancy and let's enjoy this hour away from the real world, and they'll sit there and have these really deep philosophical conversations that sometimes go way over my head but are so interesting to listen to. I don't know if I just end up standing near tables of really smart people when I'm painting often, or if everybody in the room is just incredibly smart, but it's always fascinating to listen to. With this tea party, I didn't get to hear as much of that because it unfortunately got going a bit later than I had thought it was supposed to. I think it's a lot to organize for the staff, so and especially being their first year, I think it took a little bit longer to set up for, understandably. And I had another panel to get to, so I was actually only able to paint for about an hour, whereas I normally have a 2-hour window, which is perfect. I'm able to really get in and do some good details and have a lot more relaxed, fun painting, because as you guys know, I'm not the fastest artist. But it was kind of good for it being just a 1-hour session, because as you know, I'm also trying to push myself to be a little bit faster. So I had a lot of fun having to kind of push myself to do it in just the span of an hour. And there were a couple of artists during the tea who were actually sitting on the tea, and I knew they were able to see what I was doing. So I was like, oh, pressure. But it was super fun in the long run. And I don't normally do this, but I actually wore earphones and listened to some David Misich, which a lot of you are aware he's probably my favorite musician. And I find myself listening to him a lot anytime I think there's going to be a stressful situation. And so I listened to his album, Who Bit the Moon. For those of you who don't know his music, please look it up. It's so beautiful. So I listened to some Who Bit the Moon, and I just kind of hung out and painted, and it was extremely fun as always. I like live painting a lot. I'm not very good at live sketching, unfortunately, which is something I'm hoping will change this year, because I think when you get to see the person do the sketch in addition to the painting, it's much, much more enjoyable. I'm crazy about watching people sketch. It just feels like magic to me. But what I usually do, not always, but what I'll often do to make things a little bit less stressful for myself is I'll do the sketch ahead of time. And I don't always refine it super heavily or anything, but I'll do it ahead of time. That way I can kind of relax and just do the painting process. And that's what I did with this one. I just wanted to draw a really exaggerated rabbit with strange proportions. I like drawing rabbits a lot. They're one of my absolute favorite animals to draw. I don't know why, they have been since I was a teenager. And I must not draw them do finished paintings of them as often as I want to, because whenever I say this, people are like, what? I didn't know you even liked rabbits. Which, I mean, I like every animal, but I guess I don't get the opportunity to paint them nearly as much as I'd like to, which is maybe good, or I'd paint them probably constantly. I don't know why, I just love them, especially hares. They have such, I don't know, like they have really interesting proportions. If you look up like a jackrabbit, they have these skinny little back legs, and I gave this guy kind of fat feet, but sometimes jackrabbits will have these skinny little stick legs and then this super long, almost cat-like body. And I don't know, their proportions are just kind of silly, but really elegant to me. And I love their bony faces. They have that like nose, and they, something about them almost reminds me of a combination between deer and dinosaurs. And I don't know, I just like rabbits. That's what I'm trying to say here. So I had a lot of fun painting him, and I think sometime I might like to do a video on just live painting in general, because I think I know a few artists who are kind of uncomfortable with it, and it can make them feel just a little bit too much pressure when they're trying to do it, which I understand because I have this weird thing where I'm comfortable doing panels and talking to like a room of people, but sometimes when I turn on the camera to do voice recordings, I get really, really nervous and have to do like 15 takes and it still sounds like I did just like a super amateur one take. I feel actually more comfortable doing this one today because I think I knew it was going to be really casual and a little bit longer mixed with a less serious video. So thank you for putting up with this. It's probably a good way for me to get more comfortable talking to nobody in a lonely room and not feel weird about it. But yeah, I think I might try doing a video with some tips or just advice on ways I get comfortable with doing live painting myself. I'm certainly not great at it. There's far better artists to speak on the subject, but just for my own followers, if I can ever say anything that's helpful or inspiring, I always like hearing different perspectives on the same topic from different artists because then you can kind of pick and choose what works for you. And everything I say on these little videos, I realize that it's not going to work for everybody and it's going to be different than what some people say, but I always hope that maybe some of it will vibe with some of you and be like, oh, that could help me too. I don't know, that's just my hope for doing these little podcasts. Anyway, thank you so much for listening to this long rabble. I have a few ideas for this Patreon that involve having other artists talk with me in the future. It's something I probably won't pursue right away, but I thought it might be kind of fun in the future. I've tried to record convention-based podcasts a few times over the years, but they always turned out so bad that I'm just really happy to be finally getting one out. And I'll try to do these for various events I do throughout the year. Maybe not every single event, but maybe larger events like I've got Denver Comic Con and I've also got Colorado Springs Comic Con. It might be fun to do kind of a comparison between the two because Denver is really big and Colorado Springs is Comic Con is really small. So that might be a really fun one to do kind of a comparison of. And then I have my solo show Mountain Collier this summer and I'm really, really looking forward to doing some little video podcasts about that. I think that'll be really fun for me and hopefully fun for some of you because I'm going to give some insights into the show and into the work that I probably won't put out quite as heavily into the public because it's a very personal, really visceral, raw show. And I'm not sure quite how much I want to share with everybody on it yet, but I'll share a little bit more with you because that's kind of what this Patreon is all about. Anyway, thank you again for listening. Feel free to leave feedback on what you might like to hear or what your experience has been at conventions. I would love that. I would love to hear advice from you guys as always. And take care of yourself, take care of your health. I'm about to go eat a massive bowl of vegan curry because I just got back from the gym and I feel like a complete bear, so I'm looking forward to that. Have a beautiful day or night wherever you are. Bye-bye.